Good evening. Some years ago, when a lifeboat was about to be launched, someone said to the coxswain, "You can't go out in a sea like that, you'll never come back." And the coxswain replied, "We have to go out. We don't have to come back." And tonight I want to pay a brief and simple tribute to the men who have to go out, the men of the lifeboat service. Now, who are they, these men who volunteer for this dangerous work, and what makes them do it? In fact, what goes to the making of a lifeboat man? Let me give you some facts about the service itself. There are about 150 boats stationed at various points around our coasts. This means there are some 1,300 men standing by for any emergency at sea. Since the Royal National Lifeboat Institution was founded in 1824, it has been the means of saving over 86,000 lives and many ships of every nation in peace and war. In the process of saving others, many lifeboatmen have given their lives. In 1964, our lifeboats and inshore rescue boats, recognized by the institution, were called out no fewer than 1,167 times, a record for any year since the founding of the service. 847 lives were saved last year, and 191 vessels. These figures speak for themselves, but behind the figures stand the men who realize that every time they go out, they may not come back, but who are never deterred by the thought. Now, many people will act courageously in an emergency, but I think most of us would rather avoid being put to the test, not knowing just how we might react. So it seems to me that the man who volunteers his services for emergencies only must possess a very special kind of courage. In fact, he issues a blank check on the bank of courage, a kind of promissory note stating, "I promise to pay on demand." And in the case of the lifeboatman, that demand is always met. Now, we know what goes into the construction of our lifeboats. They are designed and built to withstand the worst that the sea can do. Only the most durable woods are used, and these are laid diagonally. Teak, Western red cedar, African mahogany, and English oak. Indeed, they are so constructed as to be virtually indestructible. Now, it is easy to show the making of a cross, but who shall say what goes to the making of a Christ? Easy to show the making of a lifeboat, but what makes a lifeboat man? Is this courage of his a built-in quality, like some special feature in the boat? Is it inherited, or what? See if you can discover something of the secret for yourselves from the faces of these men. Charles Fish of Ramsgate, who carried out the famous rescue from the Indian chief. James Cable of Aldeburgh, awarded the silver medal 3 times. Robert Cross, one of the outstanding lifeboatmen of the Second World War. Henry Blogg of Cromer, the only man, apart from the founder of the institution, to win the gold medal 3 times. Patrick Sliney, who won his gold medal for a daring rescue from the Daunt Rock lighthouse ship. John McLean of Peterhead, the last Scottish coxswain to win the gold medal. William Gammon, a gold medal winner who lost his life when the Mumbles lifeboat capsized in 1947. Thomas King of Jersey, the first man to win the gold medal after the last war. Hubert Pettit of Guernsey, awarded the gold medal in 1963. Richard Evans of Anglesey, awarded the gold medal for rescuing the crew of a coaster in 1959. And lastly, Richard Walsh and William Watt Williams, each awarded the silver medal for rescuing 42 men from a tanker which had broken in two. And now, let's look at one crew, the crew of the Aberdeen lifeboat, the Ramsay Dyce. And I want you to look particularly at the faces of the men. Men like Leo Clegg, the coxswain, Bill Cooper in his 30s, the boatman, John Martin in his 50s, the oldest member of the crew, Johnny Martin, his 20-year-old son, Bob Anderson at 29, the motor mechanic and the only full-time member of the crew, Frank Cruikshank, and George Walker. Are they a race of supermen? They themselves would laugh at the very idea. They claim to be very ordinary men doing a job that's got to be done. And when the call goes out, they drop their ordinary daily job and make for the lifeboat. Do they assume new personalities? Do they become different men when they set out on their errand of mercy? They themselves would say no. They have to go out. Recent months, I have talked to many lifeboatmen and their families. A lifeboat secretary told me that in 30 years he never had a single resignation. He says it is a matter of honor with the crews. They have to keep up the good name of the ship. A bowman said, a lifeboatman is born, not made. A coxswain said simply, we go by faith. And others said, I suppose it's in the blood. My father was in the crew, and his father before him. You are the coxswain of the Aberdeen lifeboat, Leo. People would say that you look the part. But surely this isn't your full-time job.
No, it isn't really my full-time job. I teach sculpture in the Grace School of Art here in Aberdeen. I've been there for about 15 or 16 years now.
Mm. When did you join the lifeboat service?
I joined the lifeboat about 4 or 5 years ago. And I must say I've enjoyed every moment of it. One could in no sense wish for a finer group of men, a finer crew to work with than the Aberdeen lifeboat crew.
Well, I know they've got an equally high opinion of you. But why did you join the lifeboat service?
Well, I suppose there are as many reasons for joining the lifeboat as there are lifeboatmen, but on my part, I've always loved the sea. I've always wanted to be near the sea and be with the sea. And during the war, I served in the Navy and for about a year in Northern Patrol. And then later on, I served in MTBs and MGBs. And it's much the same thing, a sort of small crew, and you're working together. You're working as a team. There's no one man is more important or less important than any other. The entire group cooperate, work together, and the boat comes first in a sense, and the boat is the crew.
But Surely that isn't enough to make a man go out in the teeth of a blizzard. What would you say is the real motive behind it, and what satisfaction do you get?
Well, I suppose it'd be true to say that the real satisfaction is in accomplishing the job you set out to do, going out to sea on a bad night and being able to help some seaman or someone in distress and bring them back ashore. And I think this is the joy in having accomplished something that is worthwhile.
I remember you saying to me once that you felt that your job as a sculptor and your job as a coxswain in the lifeboat weren't two things apart, that they were, both these activities were part of life.
No, well, that's true. I mean, some people I have tended to perhaps say, well, wherein is the link? Surely there's a problem here between sculpture and lifeboat. And as far as I'm concerned, I find the two things are one, that what I learn from my students and working with them about life and about people, I can take into the lifeboat, and what I learn from working with the lifeboat crew, I can take back into the school. And to my mind, the two aspects are complementary. In fact, I think it's a very good thing to take the academic life out into the outside world and in some way make some contribution to forming a link between the world outside and the academic world.
One last question, Leo. Have you ever known fear?
Oh yes, fear is quite a real thing. But it's not a thing that you're concerned very much about. It is really an aspect of respect, an aspect of respect for the sea, for the power of the sea, and I think it, in a sense, it heightens your awareness of what it is you have to work with when you're working with the sea.
Thank you very much, Leo.
Thank you.
Now, recently I spent an evening in the house of a predecessor of Leo's, the late Tom Sinclair, who was coxswain of the Aberdeen lifeboat from 1924 to 1949. And during that period, he saved no fewer than 117 lives. And what I learned about him from those who knew him well gave me a further insight into a lifeboatman's heart and mind. John Allen, once a member of his crew, had this to say about him. Tom, he said, was the most dauntless man I ever knew, a man of great faith and great determination. Once the boat was launched, there was only one thing in his mind, to get to the ship in distress with all possible speed and to save human life at no matter what risk to his own. He was always, he said, a great inspiration to the crew. And as we would drive into the teeth of a gale, he would lead us in singing in one hymn after another. And I think I can hear him yet. Saviour, we long to follow thee. Do thou our hearts prepare to count all else, whate'er it be, unworthy of thy care? Yes, we would have gone anywhere with Tom, and in any weather. This is what his daughter had to say, amongst other things. When my father came back from a successful mission, he was the happiest man in the world. But if one life was lost, he was broken-hearted and would weep like a little child. And then I learned that on at least two occasions he rose from a sick bed to take the lifeboat to sea. On yet another occasion, when he was going on board the boat, he slipped and broke his arm. But he refused to have any attention until his mission was completed some 15 hours later. But most moving of all was the occasion when he left the bedside of his dying son to answer a call of distress. Such is the stern sense of duty of the man who feels that he has to go out. Now, on the walls of the room in which we talked about him hung testimonials to his valor, far more precious to his family than any great paintings would have been. I want you to take a close look at the center one, his certificate of service, with its masterpiece of understatement. He performed his duties to the entire satisfaction of the committee. And now I want you to look at his awards. The bronze medal presented by King George V, the silver by George VI, the clasp to the silver by the Duke of Kent. Here was a man who earned the right to stand in the presence of princes and of kings by virtue of his valor. And indeed I believe that such men are the true glory of our race. We have to go out. We don't have to come back. Alas, despite superb seamanship, it sometimes happens that the men do not come back. This was the Broughty Ferry lifeboat, Mona, whose entire crew was lost on the Mission of Mercy a few years ago. Yet even before the replacement vessel arrived, so many men had volunteered to man her that it was difficult to select a new crew. Some years ago, the Fraserborough lifeboat, returning from a mission, capsized at the harbor mouth, with many of the townsfolk looking helplessly on. There was only one survivor, yet he was the first to volunteer for the new crew next day, although his own father was lost in that disaster. How do you explain courage of this kind? I don't see why we should try to. Let us simply be proud that man can rise to such heights and leave it at that. Now, I believe that compassion, as well as courage, is part of the lifeboat man's makeup. I came across this in a paper only the other day. Orkney lifeboat help for baby. Strunsey lifeboat was called yesterday to the Orkney island of Sandy to take a newborn baby boy in urgent need of medical attention to hospital. A baby, one day old, is in urgent need of medical care, and so eight men drop whatever they are doing to take this precious little passenger across 25 miles of sea to hospital. That is compassion. And it's the same kind of compassion you're going to see in the film that follows.
Many of the cases lifeboats have to deal with are in remote areas where there are few normal services. On the island of Barra, for instance, on the southern tip of the Outer Hebrides, there is no hospital. Mrs. Dunn's baby was a fortnight overdue. It was thought advisable to get her to the hospital in South Uist. On the mainland, of course, ambulances do this job 1,000 times a day. Although an air ambulance does serve this particular island, the only landing strip is the beach, but at that time it was covered by a high tide. For Mrs. Dunn, the lifeboat was the only answer.
Oh, the gathered
Yes, undoubtedly, the lifeboat man is a man of great compassion, as well as of great courage. But it's always the courage we keep coming back to. This courage that will not be daunted by the very worst that the sea can do. Andrew Mearns, one-time coxswain of the Ferry Den lifeboat, told me that once returning from a mission, their boat was struck by an enormous wave. And this is what he said after that. I and two others were washed overboard. Time and again, the raging sea closed over me, and I never thought to see my wife and two children again. I simply prayed that God would receive me into his kingdom. Miraculously, however, he was washed up unconscious on the beach and was taken to hospital along with two of his mates, were also cast up by the sea on the shore. And in a statement written at the time, Andrew said this: we regard this as part of what a lifeboatman may expect. The other members of the crew and myself are ready to put to sea again whenever the call comes. Whenever the call comes. And Andrew was as good as his word. And now this is the Peterhead lifeboat entering the water. She bears a very proud plaque telling of three nights of ordeal in January 1942. Three successive nights when she went to the assistance of three different vessels in distress. The inset you see is a replica of the gold medal awarded to coxswain John McLean for conspicuous gallantry. That medal represents the lives of 106 men saved on these three nights of storm. And here, in my hand, I hold the life of one man, one of those who went out and did not come back. He was David Strachan, also of Peterhead, who, with his two shipmates, lost his life when the lifeboat was trying to reach a vessel on the rocks in December 1914. And this splendid medallion, the Carnegie Medal for Gallantry, was awarded to him posthumously. On one side it says, for heroic endeavor to save human life. And on the other, he serves God best, who most nobly serves humanity. If this be true, and who will question it? Then no man serve God better than the lifeboatmen. The men who have to go out, knowing full well that they may not come back. So let us salute their courage. Let us remember them in our prayers. And let us support them in their truly magnificent work.